try this time. How many of you did your homework? All right, a growing number, but I'm going to keep asking until you do it, until we get 98% or 99, and then we'll go looking for the one that won it all. Have you done it? No? The homework assignment is that you download and watch the documentary, The Mask You Live In. You did it? What did you think? You're very powerful. Wayne says, once you've seen that movie, the documentary, volunteer for more at the minute. And that's called misperception. You don't remember? There's a woman's version of it. Not as powerful. I don't think I've seen that, but I recommend. This isn't a recommendation. This is an assignment. You are not going to pass this course until you take it. Well, we're already there, but really, seriously, it will be a way to open a door to have some conversations outside of here that aren't religious, but are very powerful and need to be held about what's happening when we buy into some cultural values. So, next Sunday, I'll keep asking. So next Sunday, today is the last Sunday in the liturgical year, and it was called Christ the King Sunday. It was very, very, very late in coming into the Christian calendar, not until the 20th century, actually, this thing. But the bonus about the service today is that the very closing hymn is probably the best hymn ever written. What do you think? No? You're an authority. Lo, he comes with cloud descending. That's one of my favorite hymns. That's why I think it's the best. No personal prejudice involved there. Okay. It's a great service, great choir. So no matter who you are, no matter where you are on your spiritual journey, I am not an authority on St. Francis. This image that is shown of Francis is the oldest image that we have of him. Actually, the image comes from during his own, just shortly after his death. St. Francis of Assisi. This is on the entrance to a Benedictine abbey in Subiaco. And Sherry and I were privileged several years ago to be in Assisi on All Saints Day. We didn't know it was All Saints Day when we were there, and I kept warning all the Italians to go home so we could have the place, but they wouldn't. Yeah, so we could enjoy it. A beautiful, beautiful place. I kept having this cognitive dissonance. We went to a worship service in the Basilica, where they have a choir in residence and a full orchestra on All Saints Day, and it's just resplendent. And here is Francis having taken this vow of poverty. You wonder. He was born Giovanni di Bernardo Doni in Assisi in 1181. He didn't live very long. It was 42 years. I do know people who are authorities on St. Francis. One of them who spoke here is Sister Dr. Ilia Delio. She is of the Franciscan Order. She's written a couple of books on St. Francis. Of course, Richard Rohr, whom I quote frequently in here, he is of the Franciscan Order. I imagine most of you have likely seen the movie Brother Son, Sister Moon. It's worth it. It's good. It's a good movie. And my hunch is that all of you know what is called the Prayer of St. Francis, which is, Lord, Make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring love. Where there is offense, let me bring pardon. Where there is discord, let me bring union. Where there is error, let me bring truth. Where there is doubt, let me bring faith. Where there is despair, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, let me bring your light. Where there is sadness, let me bring joy. O Master, let me not seek as much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love, for it is in giving that one receives, and it is in self-forgetting that one finds. It is in pardoning that one is pardoned. It is in dying that one is raised to eternal life. I tried to memorize that prayer once. It was not successful. And this prayer is beautiful, but he didn't write it. It actually only dates back to 1912. And as an authority on St. Francis writes, as noble as its sentiments are, Francis would never have written such a piece. Focused as it is on the constant repetition of the pronouns I and me. And the word God, words God and Jesus are never mentioned in the prayer. Now, a lot of people, when they find this out, find it out as a shock, especially those entering the Franciscan order. This prayer even appears in the Methodist hymnal that we use. And it is there, also misattributed to St. Francis. Now, what I've just shared with you is something of a metaphor for what I think is one part of my role as a spiritual teacher, and that is to provide correct information, to correct misinformation, and to contribute to religious literacy. Richard Rohr, who is a Franciscan and an authority on St. Francis, says that the prayer St. Francis prayed over and over was, God, who are you? God, who am I? And those two questions are going to be guiding our work as we go forward. Who is God, or whatever you mean when you use or refuse to use the word God, and who are you? And what I would like to point out is that Francis didn't know. I think that's one of the things that really marks the lives of saints and mystics in all traditions, is this quality of not knowing. What Francis did know was that living with and through those questions was a way to walk a spiritual path. God, who are you? God, who am I? The mystic Meister Eckhart, who has been made accessible now through a number of translations of his sermons, his prayer was, God, deliver me from God. That is, deliver me from the stance of thinking that I know, that I understand, that I have you. You know, after we have managed, as everyone in this room has, to resolve the ego's need for security and survival, it's time to turn our attention elsewhere. Both our ego and our culture seduce us into focusing on issues of esteem, affection, power, control, to the point that if we are not careful, we will lose our lives in the process of trying to save them. I think that's pretty close to what Jesus taught, right? Who are you, God? And who am I? These are the questions that help shape the spiritual journey. I'm going to continue to use the teachings of Jesus as my central reference point of departure in an ongoing attempt to look at these questions. The teachings of Jesus can be our guide, showing us how to stand within our culture, with our culture, against our culture, and in service to our culture. And so this talk today is going to serve as an introduction to kind of the next phase of what I want to be teaching and hear. And the overall arching theme of what I'm going to be talking about is standing with Jesus. Now, frankly, I had a smidgen of hesitation to use this title because Jesus has been so hijacked by Western culture as to hardly be recognizable. When you think of the word Jesus, probably some, if you have an image of Jesus, probably some Western artist depiction of Jesus. And just recently, I mean within the last 10 years, the archaeologists who continue to do work in the area of biblical studies, they found two bodies in the area where Jesus of Nazareth actually lived. And they did a forensic reconstruction of the face of the male that they found. And they say that Jesus more than likely looked like this, rather than some Western depiction that we have of him. So if we are going to do these things, and by these things, how to stand, I'm talking about how do we stand within our culture as people of faith? How do we stand with our culture in solidarity with the culture that birthed us, taking the best things of it? How do we, when necessary, stand against our culture? And how do we stand in service to our culture? Now, we're going to do this, likely, most of us, if we've been raised in Western religious culture, are going to have to fight our way through some misperceptions, things that we have taken for granted or taken to be true. For example, most of popular evangelical Christianity focuses on teachings about Jesus. Was he the Son of God? Was he born of a virgin? Did he die for your sins? Was he literally raised from the dead? And for over 15 years now, especially since 9/11, my teaching has focused almost exclusively on teachings of Jesus. And I'm going to continue that emphasis because I have a lot to learn. By the way, somebody asked me in a discussion group I was part of the other day what I was. And this is a question that makes no sense to me. As you've heard me say on numerous occasions, don't let any label rest on you very long, because you put a label on yourself, it's a trap. So I asked a person for clarification, and this person said, well, are you a liberal or a conservative or what? I have never heard a Methodist or a Christian talk like you. Okay. Well, I don't want to be defined or confined by the label Methodist. John Wesley was not a Methodist. Like Jesus wasn't a Christian. And further, tell me what you think a Christian is, and I will tell you whether I am that or not. I stole that line from Matt Russell, and I just think it's brilliant. And then I said to the person, well, I am a radical conservative liberal. Or I am a liberal conservative radical, or perhaps a conservative liberal radical. I think I am very conservative. I want to get back, way back, to who Jesus was and what he said and not settle for some 19th century interpretation of him. I want to conserve the values that were part of the communal life that I grew up with in southern Tennessee. I think that my father imparted some conservative values to me when he said, we all do better when everybody does better. And I grew up in a place where there was a radical assumption of personal responsibility for your own well-being. And I don't think I heard the word entitlement until I was in college. People didn't have an attitude of entitlement. When the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, which is something I can remember, I was very little, we because we were dealing with a common threat. And today, if it is perceived that some foreign nation is in some way trying to do something in the United States, it seems not to unite us, but to divide us. I'm also very liberal. Look up the word in the dictionary. It means favoring reform, progress. It means being generous. It implies freedom. It is a word that favors what's best for people. You know, we all want to be around generous, giving people. And I'm a radical. The word radical means root. It has the same word root of the word that we get the word radish from. A radical wants to get to the root of the matter, not to stay on the surface. And I think the huge sin of our culture, and something that might well do us in, is the incredible superficiality of the culture in which we live. So I think that Jesus was a conservative, liberal, radical. And he calls us to follow him. Jesus wanted to reform his own religion, take it back to its roots, conserve what was best about it, and open the closed-minded leaders of his day to the radical message that was in the Jewish prophetic tradition. I was talking over my ideas for this talk today with a dear friend, and I told him that I was going to use the phrase radical, liberal, conservative. And he reminded me of something that I had totally forgotten about, but I'm so glad that he did. And it's a piece that was written by John Dominic Crossan. By the way, I do not expect you to read all of the books that you hear about in here, but I do want you to know about them. They are, to me, a valuable resource. They might be at some point for you as well. Plus, I want you to know that I'm not making this stuff up. Not to say I'm plagiarizing it, it's just that there's some scholarship that is behind this work. I would like you to be acquainted with the work of Marcus Borg. He has spoken several times right in this room. Yeah, Borg died just a couple of years ago. And I remember when he was here, he took a break and was standing right over there, and I went over to him. And I told him, I said, I want you to know that I borrow your stuff. And he responded quickly, borrow freely, my friend, borrow freely. I encourage you to check him out. He's, up until the time of his death, was probably one of the real leading authorities on the Jesus of history. And if you want to read Borg, I would start with this book. The book, Meeting Jesus Again for the First Time, that is such a brilliant title. Because most people who claim to be Christian think they know all they need to know about Jesus. But my hunch is that if you read this book, you will discover things you didn't know. Now, all of Borg's works are important. There's a joke among people who call themselves progressive Christians who have been influenced by Borg. They call themselves Borg Again Christians. Another man who has influenced contemporary scholarship regarding Jesus is the man I just mentioned, John Dominic Crossan. His book, this book, Jesus, A Revolutionary Biography, is a mind-opener, eye-opener. So a few years ago, Crossan was scheduled to speak here, and Jim Bankston, our senior minister at the time, had heard both Borg and Crossan at a conference in Oregon. And so Jim, having that personal experience with him, arranged for Crossan to preach here at St. Paul's. And Crossan is Irish. He is diminutive. He is a passionate religious scholar. He hates the church. The reason for that is the Roman Church's involvement in covering up the pedophile abuse scandal and not coming clean about that. So it was right after he was here that I got and read his autobiography. He calls it his spiritual memoir, and his book on Jesus is Jesus, A Revolutionary Biography. And his own autobiography is called A Long Way from Tipperary, What a Former Irish Monk Discovered in His Search for Truth. I tell you that reading this book at the time was a powerful religious experience for me. And I'm going to read to you the last three paragraphs of the book because it gets at what my friend reminded me of when I described myself as a radical conservative liberal. These are Crossan's words. In conclusion, this is what I have learned between Ireland and America, monastery and university, priesthood and marriage, academic scholarship and public discourse. I have learned that God is more radical than we can ever imagine, that a divine utopia on this earth is more subversive than we can ever accept, and that Pilate acted for us all when he executed Jesus. But let me repeat that in an autobiographical anecdote. Sarah, that's his wife, and I are good friends with Marianne Borg, a canon of Portland's Trinity Episcopal Cathedral, and her husband Marcus Borg, who holds an endowed chair at Oregon State University. Marcus is also one of the handful of scholars who has spent their professional life in historical Jesus research. In early March 1999, they invited Sarah and me to Oregon for a Thursday class and lecture at the university, and then for a Friday through Sunday seminar at the cathedral. After the opening session on Friday night, I was seated at a small table signing books. As I finished one book's inscription, its owner said to me, "My pastor told me not to come here tonight because you are even to the left of Borg." "Give your pastor my best regards," I replied, "and tell him that's the good news. The bad news is that both Borg and Crossan are to the right of Jesus. And worse still, Jesus is to the right of God." So the questions of St. Francis, "Who are you, God, and who am I?" will also help us form an agenda as we go forward and try to learn about and be empowered to stand with Jesus. Indeed, the teachings of Jesus will serve as a resource to help us answer those questions. They're never fully answered, at least until we lose consciousness. My favorite teaching story about who we are is one that I have not used in here for 3 years. Like any good story, it bears repeating from time to time. I just wanted you to know that I know when I last used it. Here it is. As an intern, part of my work was to travel around in teams examining patients. I would notice their looks as we entered, intimidated, apprehensive, feeling like case studies of various illnesses. I hated that, but I was an intern. I remember one guy distinctly, however, who was altogether different. I think this guy changed my life. He was a black man in his 60s, very cute, very mischievous, very sick. What brought us repeatedly to him was the utter complexity of his illness, condition on top of condition, and the mystery of why he was still alive. It was so strange. We were visiting not to find out what was wrong with him, but why he was still here at all. I had the feeling he could see straight through us. He'd say, "Hey boys," when we'd come in, the way you might when a gang of 10-year-olds come barging into a house for a snack in the middle of an intense game outside. He was so pleased with himself and so amused. Made some people nervous. I was intrigued. But for some weeks, I never had a chance to be alone with him. Now and then, he'd give in to very serious trouble, and he'd be moved into intensive care. Then he'd rally to everyone's amazement, and we'd move him back, and we'd visit him again, and he'd say, you boys here again? Pretending to be surprised that we were still around. One night, there was an emergency, and I took the initiative and went to see him alone. He looked pretty bad. But he came alert a few seconds after I entered. He gave me a grin and said, "Well, sort of like he'd expected me, like he'd known how much I'd come to love him. That happens in hospitals. I imagine I looked a little surprised at the well, but we just laughed a minute, and I stood there just so taken by who he was, and then he hit me with a single remark, half a question and half a something else. "Who are you?" he said, sort of smiling. Just that. "Who are you?" I started to say, "Well, I'm Dr.," and then I just stopped cold. It's hard to describe. I just sort of went out. What happened was that all kinds of answers to his question started to go through my head. They all seemed true, but they all seemed less than true. "Well, I'm this, yet," but that's not the whole story. The whole story is, "Well, that's not, no, no, that's not the whole picture. The whole picture is, no, that's not right either." The thought process went like that. Nothing remotely like that had ever happened to me. But I remember feeling very elated, and it must have shown because he gave me this big grin and said, "Nice to meet you." His timing killed me. We talked for 5 minutes about this and that. Nothing in particular. Children, I think. And at the end, I ventured to say, "Is there anything I can do for you?" He said, "No, I'm just fine. Thanks very much, doctor." And he paused, waiting for the name this time, and I gave it to him. And he grinned at me, really, he did. And that was it. He died a few days later, and I carry him around today. I think of him now and again in the midst of my rounds. A particular moment, a particular patient brings him back. "Who are you?" For years, I trained to be a physician, and I almost got lost in it. This man took away my degree, and then he gave it back to me with, "and also, and also, and also," scribbled across the bottom. I'll never forget that. We slap a label on ourselves, and we get lost in that identity. Mother, husband, son, father, liberal, conservative, radical, Methodist, Christian, Jewish, Muslim, whatever. The point of this story is to get the importance of answering the who you question right to the surface. None could be more important. Apart from your personal history and what you do for a living, who are you? Now, I'm going to be so bold as to say that the biggest enemy of God is organized religion. And the biggest barrier to standing with Jesus is the Bible. In the talk I gave in here a few weeks ago, I called it creative deconstruction. I began to hint some of this. I certainly don't want to come across as a negative Bible-bashing person, but I do think it's useful to expose the misuse of Scripture as a way to introduce people to a way to recover the true depth and meaning of text that I believe enable and even empower us to see the divine image in the face of every person and to assist in calling everyone, ourselves included, into fuller life and living, and to discover in the teachings what it might mean to stand with Jesus. Paul Tillich, a theologian who has had incredible shaping influence on me and my teaching, wrote, "The Bible is a subject of interpretation. There is no doctrine, no prophet, no priest, no power, which has not claimed biblical sanctions for itself." You know, the Bible is a strange, powerful book. It's been a bestseller every year since it was first printed. Indeed, when Gutenberg invented the movable type printing press, the Bible was its first product. Now, whether you have ever read the Bible or not, and I don't think that necessarily something I would recommend, that you just sit down and read the Bible without a good guidebook in hand, and if you want one, I would refer you to another of Marcus Board's works called Reading the Bible Again for the First Time. But even if you have never read the Bible, you have been influenced by it. You've been influenced by its words and ideas. There are phrases from the Bible that populate our popular unconscious. No doubt you've seen many motion pictures based on biblical stories. Phrases from the Bible have worked their way into our vocabulary. Green pastures, East of Eden, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, for crying out loud, sour grapes, holding out the olive branch. And one of my mother's favorites, it was her swear word, land of Goshen. That was the section east of Egypt that housed the slaves. But in the history of the Western world, the Bible has left a trail of pain, horror, blood, and death. So much so that Shelby Spong devotes an entire book to it called The Sins of Scripture. And this fact is not very often allowed to rise to consciousness. So some of my teaching going forward is going to be an effort to correct this. So this is a profound paradox. The Bible has been used by those who believe it to be God's word to justify killing and to oppress others. Passages from the Bible have been used to bless the bloodiest of wars. Spong writes, people committed to the Bible have not refrained from using the cruelest forms of torture on those whom they believe to have been revealed as the enemies of God in these sacred scriptures. The Bible has been used to justify violence done to racial minorities, women, and Jews, and homosexuals. That is hard for some Christians to understand, but it is not difficult to document. It just is no good. So I think we need to look at this. How is it possible that the Bible, universally revered in Western religious circles, could be the source of so much evil? Now, there's no other word for it. Can this be turned around? Can the Bible be seen as a source for the kind of life Jesus talked about and that I describe as being marked by peace, love, joy, and patience? Along with Borg, I want to take the Bible seriously, not literally, and nobody takes the Bible literally, not even people who say they do. Such people actually cherry-pick passages that support their point of view. If you sit in the back where the Holy Spirit does not get to, the caption on the cartoon is, "Today I'll be cherry-picking from Deuteronomy." I have a multitude of reasons for wanting to do this work. For one thing, the Bible was given to me as the foundational and identity document of my faith, just like the English language was given me to speak. I grew up in a house filled with Bibles. There is now in our living room the family Bible that was handed down from generation to generation. The earliest entry in this one that you see is from 1891. There is a blue ribbon in this Bible from the Tennessee Centennial in 1897. And although the Bible, it didn't always sit on the stand, it was on a coffee table, you couldn't put anything else on top of the Bible. That was verboten. Although people did put things in the Bible. Like sometimes they would press leaves in the pages of the Bible, right? Causing one little girl, when she opened it, to claim that she had found Adam's pant. That's not in my notes. Bible stories were part of the curriculum in public schools when I grew up. As a matter of fact, I think that public schools in the South were little more than Protestant parochial schools. We opened with prayer. We had sometimes when the teacher didn't have a good lesson plan, she would ask people to go around and cite their favorite Bible verse. Every school I attended until I went to military school, which is probably a surprise to some of you, but every school I began with a prayer. And there was a Bible story or a Bible passage. And the Bible was treated unlike any other book that we had. It's even printed differently if you look at a Bible. It's printed in two columns on a page, right? Only the Bible and the dictionary are printed like that. And they kind of treat it in the same way. That if you want to know an answer to one of life's ultimate questions, you just go to the Bible and open it up, and it will give you what you want. And it's referred to, even in the liturgy across the street, across the plaza, when the scripture is read, and it is the reading is concluded by saying, "This is the word of the Lord, the word of God." Now, in Islam, the Quran is treated even more special than the Bible, because in Islam, the Quran is analogous to Jesus in the Christian faith. It's really sacred. And maybe it is this love for the Bible has given so many people the ability not to see the gory passages, the passages that simply don't fit the image of a loving, forgiving God. The fact is that in the Bible, there are passages that are very disturbing, malevolent, or even, as I said, evil. Now, you add to this the fact that I grew up privileged. Now, I don't mean economically. My family was modest economically. But my privilege was that I was a white, male, heterosexual Christian. And the Bible, or so I was taught, affirmed the value of each of those privileged designations. It was clearly preferable to be white than a person of color. Male, because all descriptions of God, unless you really look, were male rather than female. Jesus made several feminine references to the sacred. It was best to be normal in sexual orientation rather than abnormal, as homosexuality was thought and taught to be. And it was best to be Christian, which everyone knew was the one right religion. I grew up infected by each of these notions. Now, fortunately, I've had the good fortune to encounter some people along the way who showed me what Karl Barth, a very conservative German theologian, by the way, but he did work in giving a lot of people the Bible back, because he taught that there was a strange new world in the Bible that we could access. And they taught me, these teachers, to put it in the briefest of sentences, that the Bible was not written for us. It was written for a particular people in a specific time, and we could, by freeing it from those constraints, find the relevancy that it has for our times and our lives. You know, I hope you know, I love what I get to do in here. If it's true that people have a calling, I'm doing what I was called to do, teach. I believe there are things in the Judeo-Christian tradition that will contribute to the transformation of our lives and to the transformation of our world if we will liberate them and allow ourselves to be liberated by them. They are not things that you often hear in church. But to hear them and speak them is what I mean by standing with Jesus. So I'll tell you a few things that I think Jesus says to us. Jesus says, there is only one way to tell if someone has gotten my message, and that is if they love. Jesus says the realm of reality where God is here and now, not off out there somewhere else. You don't have to go anywhere to get to heaven. Jesus says, unless you have reached perfection, which is an absolutely lousy idea in the spiritual realm, it belongs only in the realm of mathematics, but unless you have reached the realm of perfection, don't judge anybody else. Jesus says the way to peace is giving up trying to control things and people to make you feel safe, secure, and happy. It will never work. Jesus says thinking that you have the truth figured out actually arranges it so that you wouldn't know the truth if it snuck up behind you and hit you on the head. Jesus said, don't make a religion out of me. Rather, embrace and give expression to my spirit and truth. Now, if you do that, many people may think you're a heretic. You might get kicked out of a church or two, or you might be snubbed. Don't worry, you're on the right track. Jesus said, don't claim to love God and then hate people in whatever form you do. Those two things can't be true at the same time. Jesus said, God told me I was his. I belong to God. So do you. Quit fearing that you are somehow separated. You never have been. Jesus says, quit apologizing for being human. If humanity is an affront to God, how can I be one with God? Jesus says, God is not up in the sky. You want to see God? You're looking at God when you truly see me. Or go look in a mirror. That's what God looks like. You read the Jesus story, and if you come up with other messages, I'd like to know them. Paul Tillich, whom I referred to earlier, wrote some words that, and I can't underestimate the impact that Paul Tillich and his writings have had on my life since I was in high school forward. He contributed the phrase, the ground of being, the courage to be, many other things. Paul Tillich wrote some words that has served as one of my overarching goals for my teaching. He said, I only want to show you something I have seen and tell you something I have heard, which is that here and there in the world and now and then in ourselves, there's a new creation. I believe that we will see this new creation more clearly when we develop the courage, the resources, the willingness, and the will to stand with Jesus. No matter where you go this week, no matter what happens, remember this, you carry precious cargo, so I will see you here next Sunday, and all of you will raise your hand about doing the homework assignment. See you.